Welcome to the Heal Your Hunger Show, where we get to the heart of why you overeat and how to stop. If you struggle with food and weight like I did, welcome home. Welcome, everybody, to the Heal Your Hunger Show. So happy to have you here today. It's really a pleasure, and it's gorgeous, gorgeous spring weather. I'm really excited about just how beautiful it's getting outside. A great, great opportunity to be outside and get some exercise and just be alive and enjoy being alive. If you're here for the first time at the Heal Your Hunger Show, welcome. Here's where we talk all about everything pertaining to the emotional eater, because after all, we emotional eaters need a place to hang out and talk about not just diets, not just weight loss, not just things having to do with nutrition, but really delving into the underlying causes of emotional eating and why we eat even though we know better, right? Because that's the hardest thing is, when we keep turning to those ooey gooey chewy foods, even though we know they hurt us and we can't control ourselves once we start. I always say there's no such thing as one. It's the just one theory, right? So anyway, welcome. Glad that you're here. And I have an awesome guest here today. I'm so excited to have him here. He is doing amazing things in the world to help people struggling with type 2 diabetes. Dr. Brian Mowll is the founder and medical director of SweetLife Diabetes Health Centers, and he serves clients worldwide as a diabetes coach. And he's a really amazing educator, and he's one of the first doctors to be certified to practice functional medicine by the prestigious Institute for Functional Medicine. But since 1998, Dr. Mowll has been helping people across North America to optimize their health and metabolism, control blood sugar, and reverse type 2 diabetes using a natural personalized lifestyle approach. So that's right up my alley. Welcome, Brian. Glad to have you here.
Thank you, Tricia. Very excited to be here with you today.
Yeah, it's awesome. I love what you're doing. And you have your Diabetes Summit, which is an annual thing, and it's happening now. So that's super cool. And, I love that you're really teaching people like me, really the underpinnings of what creates the symptom of diabetes and just like the symptom of emotional eating. And they go together, right? A lot of people with type 2 diabetes are emotional eaters and they're eating the wrong foods and they're, really causing health issues like type 2 diabetes on account of it. So how'd you get into this? Do you have any personal story around diabetes?
That's a great question. Not really a personal story, but a professional story. You know, for me, diabetes is something that once I started helping people with diabetes, it became very exciting for me, and it became a passion and a labor of love. I still remember my first diabetes client. I've been practicing for about 20 years, and it was a couple years in, and I had somebody, I was doing nutrition classes, workshops and things, and I had somebody come to one of those, and they had type 2 diabetes. I didn't think that much of it because it wasn't something that I was necessarily treating at that time specifically. But they started asking me some questions. They made some lifestyle and dietary changes based on the workshop that I did, and would ask me follow up questions. And then I saw them about a month later, and they had lost 10 pounds. They were doing way better. And then about 90 days after that workshop, this lady had actually completely reversed her diabetes. And I was like, wow, that's amazing. So I started doing more research into it and really kind of figuring out how can we help more people with this? Because this is exciting. I always loved the idea of changing people's lives and actually helping to save somebody's life. And as you know, diabetes is a killer. Not only diabetes, but the complications, heart disease, stroke, sexual dysfunction, Alzheimer's and dementia, kidney failure, blindness, amputation, all these things go with diabetes. And when you can have that kind of an impact on somebody's life, it really fuels your passion to want to do more of that. So I kind of got the bug to want to learn as much as I could. And so, I went back and became a certified diabetes educator and then a master diabetes educator and really got into functional medicine and kind of changed my whole practice around to to try to help people with not only diabetes, but pre-diabetes, metabolic syndrome, obesity, and overweight, and kind of everything that I call on this, you know, type 2 diabetes spectrum.
Absolutely. That's awesome. And it is so hopeful because type 2 diabetes can be reversed. And so it's just like, you know, the way we got in is the way we're going to get out. We're going to address how we got there in order to get out of there. And so what are some of the top things that you do recommend to people if they come in there and they're like, you know, they're serious. Obviously, this is important. They need to really want to overcome it, right? I'm sure you see people who aren't on fire to reverse it and those who are. So let's say you come in, somebody comes in, they're ready, they're willing, you know, they're going to do what it takes with your help. What's the first thing you do with them?
Well, the first thing is we have to realize that it's not all about diet, but diet is a big factor. So, you know, we'll do a full consultation with a person, a functional medicine workup, and try to find out where, you know, the biggest sort of lapses are, where the biggest challenges are with their health. And if it's, you know, like my average client, there are a number of things, but diet is one of them. So that's oftentimes where we'll start. Now, there are people who come to see me whose diet is already good. You know, they're eating a good quality diet, they're eating real foods, they're eating low carb, they're doing all the right things, but they're not sleeping well, or they've got a major gut issue, or they've got major hormone imbalances or something like that, which all, believe it or not, can affect blood sugar. So there are cases where we'll go in different directions right from the beginning. But for most people, we just have to start with diet. It's probably 50 to 70% of the picture for most people. Mm-hmm. So then where we start with diet is first, look at real food, eliminate processed, refined foods. And that may sound pretty obvious, but it's amazing how many people will eat organic this and gluten-free and all these things, but they're still eating packaged foods. You know, they're still going to restaurants and eating foods filled with refined processed vegetable oils and refined carbohydrates that are sneaking into the sauces and salad dressings and things that they're eating. So for me, it starts with real food and making sure that you're trying to eat as little packaged processed foods as possible before we start looking at whether it's gluten-free or whether it's organic and so forth. Those things are important too, but let's start with making sure we're eating real food first.
Okay, let me interrupt you. Sure. What are some of these hidden things that are in these packaged foods that people need to be alerted to?
Yeah, great question. So there's three main things that I encourage people to avoid. One is refined processed carbohydrates. So that could be from grains or, you know, beans or other, you know, starchy vegetables like potatoes and so forth. But try to avoid refined processed carbohydrates, and sugar, of course, is one of those. So avoid refined sugar. So that may show up as rice flour, potato starch, or wheat flour, or corn starch, or, you know, anything like that, dextrose, you know, all of these. And then, of course, all the sugars and all the different names of sugar. So those, that's the first thing. The
okay, second so thing, somebody, let me interrupt you. Somebody, I want to dig into this.
Of course.
Somebody's like, oh, beans, but I was told beans were good for you. You know, how come that's really, you know, is that really spiking my blood sugar?
Well, beans might be okay for, might be good for a large percentage of the population, or they might not be. You know, there's some challenges with beans, but at least for now, you know, I'm talking about the, you know, the sort of this refining processing of beans. So we don't want to eat like textured soybean protein, for example, or even some sort of, you know, some sort of bean powder, like a chickpea powder or something in a, you know, a chip, because we think it sounds healthier. It's still a refined processed packaged food. And I think we should try to eliminate those as much as possible.
Because these are spiking people's blood sugar. The more refined, the more instant hit to their blood sugar.
That's right. That's right. And the more removed it is from its natural state. So it doesn't have its fiber. A lot of the enzymes are missing or broken down. A lot of the phytonutrients could have been degraded. So we're not getting the things. For example, if there's things in foods that go well beyond macronutrients like carbs, protein, and fat. For example, berries, which are a fruit and have sugar. There's been studies done on people with diabetes that if you take the amount of sugar in berries and give it to someone, it's going to spike their blood sugar. But if you if you give them the berries, their blood sugar actually goes down. And the reason they have surmised is because of the phytonutrients and these plant compounds that are in the berries, these antioxidants and other phytonutrients that actually have a beneficial effect on our blood sugar metabolism that outweighs the sugar that's in those berries.
Wow,
plus they have fiber and other things. It's interesting.
That's so interesting. And how many berries? Are we talking half a cup or what?
That's about what I recommend for people with blood sugar dysregulation. It's about a half a cup of berries, I think, is fine. And, you know, for someone like, I have a 16-year-old son who's very active and growing and, you know, plays a lot of sports and so forth and is like a noodle, you know, super metabolism. He can certainly do more than that. I mean, he could do he'll do a carton of raspberries in 30 seconds and it's not a problem for him. But if somebody's dealing with, you know, obesity or overweight or blood sugar dysregulation, we want to limit that probably to about a half a cup.
So yeah, fruit's an issue because I always say emotional eaters, you know, an idea of a fruit to them is a banana because it's the most most carby, sugary, you mm-hmm. know, fruit that they can eat. I know That was always my favorite fruit. So, but those, the higher the sugar content and sugar hit, obviously that's why you're recommending the berries because those are lower.
Right. Lower. But you're right. There are people who, because of addictions or cravings or what have you, anything that tastes sweet can be potentially a problem. So, right. You know, we do have to apply this on an individual basis. And some people we do eliminate all fruit, or sometimes we'll say only eat fruit seasonally, you know, so just maybe a little bit here and a little bit there when it's in season, but try to keep it in real low moderation.
Yeah. And then do you recommend no grains, like a real paleo diet?
Yeah, I don't like grains for a number of reasons. The biggest reason for me from a blood sugar perspective is they're fairly calorie dense and nutrient poor, believe it or not. So grains have a lot of starch, a very small amount of fiber, and a little bit of nutrition, you know, some minerals and things. But compared to, you know, the same weight in vegetables, there's no comparison. So vegetables, you know, I'd rather see somebody do vegetables than grains. And there's other problems with grains. You know, you have gluten, you have lectins, you have other potential anti-nutrients, which can affect nutrient absorption in the gut and cause damage to the gut. But the big thing for me is the starch. You know, there's just way too much starch in grains for people with blood sugar dysregulation. The trade-off, there's just not enough benefit there.
Yeah, totally. And I'm a big proponent of that as well. I mean, I used to be 50 pounds overweight. And so, you know, I gain weight really easily. And mm-hmm. so that's, you know, the paleo way is so much better, the no grain, whatever way you go, keto, whatever. But I find even just from a foodie standpoint, like I can eat more if I'm not having grains in my diet. I mean, I make killer salads or a cauliflower rice, you know, meal or whatever. And it's when it's all vegetables and non-carby vegetables, I can eat a nicer quantity. Mm-hmm. And if I'm eating grains, it's like I can't really tolerate that or metabolize that much. So for all those who are just, you know, starting to go into mourning over the idea of giving up your grains, it's like, no, you can have a better meal when you're not having the calories and the, you know, the density of the grains.
Yeah, I believe in nutrient density, which interestingly is something that the vegan community, plant-based community really pushes, the idea of nutrient density of foods. But, you know, sort of ironically, a lot of the foods they're recommending aren't really nutrient dense like grains, whereas vegetables certainly are. Some fruits are, but again, you've got to be careful with the sugar. But a lot of meats, eggs, and things like that are very nutrient dense. So I think nutrient density is an important concept.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you have a preference of cooked or raw? I mean, I know things get more carb rich when they're cooked, some vegetables.
Well, I think starchy vegetables do, but you know, most of those you're going to eat cooked anyway. I mean, yeah, if you're going to eat them, you're going to eat them cooked anyway, like a white potato, you're probably not going to eat raw. As far as veggies, I think it depends on the veggie. Cruciferous vegetables, I like cooked. Research actually shows that you extract more nutrients from them when they're cooked, steamed in particular, or sauteed in oil, as long as you're eating the oil. Boiling is going to strip away a lot of the vitamins and nutrients. That's if you're dumping the water, of course. And microwaving seems to damage them. So I think depending on how you cook them, steaming and ultimately sauteing would probably be the best way to cook them. But cooking actually brings out a lot of the nutrition from things like broccoli and cauliflower and Brussels sprouts and so forth. Mm-hmm. Whereas if it's something like a tomato, cooking actually brings out more of the acid and I think it kind of goes both ways. It may bring out more of the lycopene as well, which is one of the helpful phytonutrients. But I tend to eat those. If I'm going to eat them, I tend to eat them raw, cucumber, salad greens, things like that.
What about carrots?
So carrots have fiber and sugar, not a lot of starch, but fiber and sugar. And when you break down the fiber, which cooking does, it's going to make the sugar more absorbable. So it is going to give you a higher blood sugar spike, a cooked carrot versus a raw carrot. So I would eat the carrots raw, but I would also, because of the sugar content, I would add some healthy fat and or protein to anything where you're going to do something with sugar. So with carrots, you know, you can have a handful of almonds, for example, with them, or something that has some healthy fat and protein in it, which will delay the absorption of the sugar from the carrots.
Makes sense. Now, I want to just circle back on the Brussels sprout and cruciferous vegetable thing, because I am like addicted to Brussels sprouts. They're like my number one food that I crave. And it's so weird. I never thought a million years I would be craving Brussels sprouts. And praise God I am, because that's progress on my part. But
for sure.
But is there some carb thing going on there that I would crave a cooked or roasted Brussels sprout?
Well, there are a few grams of carbs in Brussels sprouts, but it's not, I don't think that's what's triggering the craving. I just think Brussels sprouts are good. You know, it's like one of those things, it's like coffee. I don't know how you feel about coffee, but I use it as an example because, you know, most kids just don't like the taste of coffee. It's kind of bitter but it's very complex. It has a very complex flavor to it. And I think Brussels sprouts are similar. A lot of vegetables are, to be honest. Spinach is another one. And kale and other greens, things like broccoli rabe. You know, these are things that most kids don't like because they're kind of bitter and complex in flavor. And I think Brussels sprouts are that way too. But sort of once you know how to cook them, you know, you cook them with some, you roast them with a little bit of olive oil, or maybe you cook them with some bacon or something that brings out the flavors, then that complexity of flavor does almost become addictive. But that's a good kind of addiction, right?
It is. It's the best. So, and in LA, they do this. I don't know if they do it where you live, but they, there's some restaurants. Of course, I have them staked out, but there's some restaurants that have the great, it's almost like they're fried. I mean, they're so good and they're wicked oily.
Yeah.
They definitely have either prosciutto or a little bit, or there's one that has almonds and a little bit of a soy type sauce or something, a little bit of sweet. But I'm telling you, they have me every single time. So anyway,
I'm with you. I love, I always look for Brussels sprouts on the starters or side list.
Yeah, they make them good. They're not like steamed, like they're not boring. They're really exciting. So that's cool. Okay. So that's the nutrition part of it. And meat. So you're obviously getting them to eat some good protein in terms of meat, probably, right?
I think protein is really important. It's the most satiating of all the macronutrients. And we don't want to overeat protein. You can definitely overconsume protein if you're not careful, but we want to get enough. You know, it's important to maintain lean body mass. We need all those amino acids. They make us feel full. and they actually fuel the healing and repair of our muscles, of our lean body mass, encourage growth of lean body mass. We need those amino acids for detoxification and neurotransmitter production, so brain chemical production. So we need the proteins are really important. And to me, you know, if we look at animal protein, a lot of the vitamins, minerals, and so forth we need are already packaged in the way we use them in these meats. So something like vitamin A, you know, doesn't exist in the plant kingdom. We can convert beta carotene to vitamin A, but vitamin A we can get directly from animal products. So I think that there's a shortcut there. Same thing with something like omega-3 fats, like DHA and EPA exist in the usable form in fish. Whereas if we get them from vegetable sources like walnuts, we can convert those oils, but you know, it's sort of a lengthy process that involves a lot of energy and enzymes. So if we can get them in their usable form, I think nature intended it that way. It seems like to me anyway, and that there's an advantage to that. So yeah, I like good quality proteins and lots of healthy fat as well.
That's great. And do people give you, I mean, nowadays, I think it's becoming, at least anybody who's trying to be healthier, they're getting the idea. And I'm certainly, you know, being a big proponent of this, of healthy fats, and that we shouldn't be fat phobic, you know, and that there's good fats that really help nourish us, help us not crave. You know, they're just really amazing. And it's just the mindset shift from where we used to be that fat wasn't, you know, was the evil one. Now it's sugar, right? So you don't get much pushback in terms of people not wanting fats in their diet. I mean, are most of your clients who have type 2 diabetes, are they overweight necessarily?
Well, most are, but most I would say is like 60%, which may be a smaller percentage than one might assume.
Right.
So, you know, maybe 40% are not, there may be normal weight. And then, you know, maybe 15% are underweight, trying to actually gain weight. And so there are a lot of differences. And again, it's not all about diet. There's not one cause. Type 2 diabetes shows up in different people in different ways. But as far as fat consumption, you know, it's pretty clear now that eating fat doesn't make us fat. Mm-hmm. It's pretty clear that eating fat doesn't raise our cholesterol, and that there are other circumstances that need to be present for fats to have a negative impact on our health. And now they can. There are certain people with certain genetic tendencies who eating a diet high in saturated fats, for example, could be problematic. Mm-hmm. But for most people, that's not the case. You know, the data is pretty clear that it's not eating cholesterol that raises our cholesterol. It's not eating fat that makes us fat. In fact, if you give an underweight person, if you tell them to drink, you know, I don't know, 5 tablespoons of olive oil a day to try to make them gain weight, they won't gain weight. It doesn't work.
Wow.
So it's actually it's the starch and the carbs that essentially raise insulin, which ultimately causes us to store fat or prevents us from burning fat. So if you tell somebody to drink 5 tablespoons of olive oil and eat a couple of potatoes at the same time, yeah, they're gonna gain weight, and probably not gonna be good for their blood sugar either. But the oil alone, the fat alone won't do it. So that's an interesting observation that a lot of people who are in type 1 diabetes care have noticed, because a lot of type 1s are very thin. They don't make insulin. So their insulin levels have to, you know, they have to inject insulin, and many of them are trying to gain weight. And so for years, people tried to give them lots of fat and that didn't work. So it's not the fat that makes us fat.
Wow. So type 1, I mean, can you give them more carbs than the type 2s?
Not real well. It's a balance. You know, it's, you know, they still do better on a low carb diet, but if they really need to gain weight, which some of them do. I mean, some of them start, you know, really emaciated because maybe they weren't controlled for a while. Ultimately, once they get good control of their blood sugar, their weight will normalize. But for them, sometimes you do have to introduce some healthy versions of starches, still real food sources, and then have them inject insulin to manage that. But that, in addition to the right amount of protein and healthy fats, can help them stabilize their weight and actually start to put on some lean body mass.
Gotcha. So what are some of the other factors that do contribute to type 2 diabetes?
Well, I think one of the big ones, which I'd love to talk to you about, is stress. You know, stress is something that isn't given a lot of play in diabetes care. You know, doctors, endocrinologists, primary care physicians who are managing their patients with diabetes, I don't really look at it. I mean, they know that stress is a factor because, you know, there's something in conventional diabetes care called, you know, sick day care, where, you know, we know that if somebody's fighting an infection, that it's going to stress their system and their blood sugar is going to spike up from that. We also know that when people are under stress, it raises their blood sugar. But other than managing that, you know, saying, okay, you're under stress, let's, you know, give you more drugs. Conventional medicine does very little to address the underlying causes of that stress. And I think that's really important. That's something that we spend a lot of time with our clients on, is really mapping out where their stressors are coming from, trying to find ways to eliminate, if possible, or balance those stressors whenever they can. So I like to really help people become aware of all the different sources of stress in their life, and particularly distress, you know, which is stress that can have a negative impact on the body. And so we look at that as three different categories. There's everyday sort of life stressors, things like bills and schedules and responsibilities and overwhelm and relationships that are challenging, and traffic jams and all kinds of stuff, you know, all the things that can affect us on a daily basis. So I encourage people to write all those out, you know, anything that you feel may have an impact on your mental, emotional state over the course of any given day. Make a list of those. Then we also have to look at major life events. And this is something that people often forget about. You know, maybe they were divorced 5 or 6 years ago, so they don't think about it all the time, but somewhere they're still harboring some, you know, unhealed, emotions from that. Maybe a little bit of resentment, or maybe some unforgiveness, or maybe just some sadness that they haven't, you know, fully grieved or healed through. Or perhaps they lost a child or a parent and it was particularly hard on them. A move can do it, a change in job, a change in a financial situation, a personal illness. All of these major life events can have a lasting impact on us. And oftentimes we forget about those. So I encourage people to write all those down as well. Now, again, if it's something you know you've worked through, I was divorced 10 years ago, but I'm in a great place now, you know, I'm over it, blah, blah, blah. Maybe that's not so much of a factor, but I think people, if they really spend some time thinking about it, can start to bring some of this up and say, you know what, maybe that is still having somewhat of an effect on me. So we just need to at least put it on paper, bring some awareness to it. And then the third category, which is actually the biggest, is physiological stressors. And this is something that many people don't think about, but these are things like chronic pain. People have back pain and other issues that drive stress into the system. Gut dysbiosis and leaky gut, chronic infections like a candida or yeast infection or Epstein-Barr or Lyme disease that they're carrying around with them. People have food allergies or food sensitivities, chronic inflammatory issues, conditions like autoimmune diseases that they're also living with, hormone imbalances, hypothyroidism, adrenal burnout and fatigue, sex hormone dysregulation. You can see this is a huge category and something that really needs to be investigated. So a good questionnaire can oftentimes bring a lot of that out, and we have all of our clients do that. Asking the right questions and getting some, again, bringing some light and awareness to those things. But we look at these three categories. This is a lot of stuff, and you can see where all of this stress comes from. And the thing is that all of these stresses essentially get processed through our, you know, HPA axis, our hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, and our adrenal system has to regulate how those affect and impact the body and what the body's response to those are. We have to respond to them somehow. And oftentimes, they lead to elevations in blood sugar. So all of these things can have an effect on the blood sugar in the long run.
That's fascinating that that kind of thing can translate into imbalance in blood sugar. I never even thought of that.
Amazing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. No, that makes a lot of sense. And, you know, my programs are definitely geared towards helping people deal with stress, because that's, people are stress eating, obviously. And I find too that their actual personality traits of emotional eaters that create stress as well, like people pleasing or being overly sensitive, you know, and self, you know, self-centered in terms of as everything being about me, and that kind of thing, because that creates a lot of stress as well. Emotional stress. So that's amazing. So after people take this evaluation, do you actually dig in and deal with these different health issues? Because that's a lot of, like, especially when in category three, I mean, that opens a whole nother can of worms, any one of those particular issues, autoimmunity or whatnot.
You know what I like to do with people is we talk about the big four, and the big four categories for me are diet, physical activity, sleep, and stress meaning everything I just went over. And so sometimes we have to look at each of those individually first, but once we do, just do a quick 1 to 10 on how well you think you have those sort of under control or mastered. So in other words, if everything I said about diet, got that, done that, you know, good with that, you know, maybe diet's a 9 out of 10. If you're exercising and you're active and you're fit, you know, maybe that's a 9 out of 10 or an 8 out of 10. If you're sleeping like a, you know, sleeping really well, I always say sleeping like a baby, and I don't know why, because babies don't sleep very good. But, but if you're sleeping well, and again, that's not an issue, maybe that's, you know, an 8 or 9 out of 10, you got that one handled. And then we look at the stress, and, you know, perhaps that's where you go, ooh, you know, there's, yeah, I have this and I have this and I have this, and, you know, I can see how all these affect me. So maybe that one is a 5 or a 6, you know, that's the one that needs the most improvement. So you give yourself a quick 1 to 10 on all of those, and whichever one, you know, has sort of the lowest rating, like the most room for improvement, I recommend focusing on that first, because we try to find the big levers, you know, the things that are going to move you and your health the most and the fastest. Mm-hmm. And so if your diet is an 8 out of 10 and your stress is a, you know, as far as how well you have it handled, if your diet is an 8 out of 10 and, or 7 out of 10, and your stress is a 4, and then you start obsessing over, you know, cutting your carbs from 50 grams to 30 grams and, you know, eating all organic foods and trying to figure out what the heck is it that you're eating that's driving your blood sugar up, you're kind of missing the point a little bit. So so I think just starting with a good self-assessment in those four areas can help to give you some direction on what to focus on.
Mm-hmm. Great. And so the sleep, I mean, obviously sleep can be worsened by this condition, but you're saying sleep can also exacerbate this condition.
Yeah. Yeah. And sleep is one of those factors that has been shown through a lot of research to affect metabolism, to affect our gut microbiome, to affect hormone balance. Poor sleep can cause insulin and leptin resistance, which can interfere with the signals of when we're full and when we're hungry,
right,
and can affect the way we process carbohydrates and fat. So poor sleep has a major influence on our metabolism. And if we're not sleeping well, that can be a deal breaker sometimes.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's amazing. And then, I mean, 8 hours of sleep seems to be almost too ideal these days, right? So what do you recommend to people?
Well, yeah, it's a good question. And I think we have to look at quality as well as quantity. So some people get very poor quality sleep and need like 10 or 11 hours to feel rested. Mm. Others seem to be able to thrive on, you know, 7 hours of sleep. So I think quality is really important. The beginning of your night's rest, so to speak, seems to be even more important than the end. I think we get most of our deep restorative sleep towards the beginning. A sleep cycle is about 90 minutes, and we may have, four or five sleep cycles over the course of a night. And the initial sleep cycles, like the first and second sleep cycle, we get much more of that deep delta wave sleep, which is really healing and restorative. So if you're not getting good quality sleep when you go to bed, and some of the things that can affect that are medications, the food we eat right before we go to sleep at night, if you're eating something sweet or sugary before bed, and you're trying to break that down and it's, you know, sending your hormones into chaos, you're probably not going to get good quality sleep. Alcohol before bed is generally not a good idea. It doesn't affect sleep in a positive way. It may make you drowsy, but it can have a negative impact on your sleep. So we have to look at some of those things. Also, the amount of light in the room, the temperature in the room, whether you were, you know, reading a mystery novel or watching the news and seeing some country getting bombed right before you put your head down on your pillow, those things can affect the quality of your sleep, especially early in the night. So I think we have to be really sacred with an evening routine and making sure that we set some pretty clear boundaries around what we're going to allow into our consciousness and into our bodies in the couple hours before we go to sleep each night.
Amen to that. I totally agree. And it's amazing how these things, I mean, it's almost like whatever ailment a person has, it's almost the same prescription for whatever it is, right?
It's true.
I mean, gut issues, you have anxiety, you get this or that, you got to get better sleep, you know? And you
because the real healer is the body. So whatever we can do to support the body and bringing itself back into balance and healing, that's going to eliminate pretty much whatever condition we're talking about, right?
Yeah. And I think we just need reminders, and we need to give reminders to people because we always want that quick fix. And I think that's why we're such a pharmaceutical nation now, is that we're just, you know, we forget that we can heal from within, you know, with the foods that we eat and the lifestyle that we live. And we just don't think of it. We just think of what's the quickest way to my end goal. And if it seems like it's pharmaceutical, that's the way I'm going to go. So
yeah.
I love these reminders here, Brian. They're just great. And to wrap things up, you have a gift for people, which sounds totally cool. Will you explain that?
For sure. And I'll mention a couple quick things. The Diabetes Summit's going on right now, which is a free 7-day, amazing event, education. It's all online. You can learn all about blood sugar regulation, metabolism, weight loss, healthy eating, food addiction, overcoming problems, sleep, avoiding toxins. We cover a lot, and it's going on right now. So that's the diabetessummit.com. You can check that out. The gift I have is called the Blood Sugar Manifesto. So I have this sort of philosophy that I always want to give away the best of the best. I want to give people everything. I don't want them to feel like they need to, you know, buy stuff from me I want to have a huge impact on as many people as possible. And I like to disseminate the best information I can. So I put together this guide, which is essentially what we do with our clients, you know, our private clients that pay us thousands and thousands of dollars. We talk all about diet and nutrition. We talk about physical activity. I break down the stress areas that I went over with you today, and sleep and supplementation and all the things that I think are important for people to do when they want to improve their blood sugar and metabolic health. So that's a free gift for anybody who wants it.
Thank you. And we have that link in the show notes here for anybody who wants to go there to healyourhunger.com and click on this show and you'll get that link. So thank you for that very generous gift. And then lastly, I have a question for you, Brian, and that is, being that this is the Heal Your Hunger show, what is your deepest hunger?
I think connection. I love to connect with you know, with other people. I think that, you know, we're put on this planet to support each other and love each other. And in the internet age, you know, in the information age, there are new ways to do that, which can be wonderful, but we have to be a little bit careful because it's very easy to have superficial interaction and miss that deep interconnectedness that I think we all need. So I think my biggest hunger is connection with other human beings who are here, especially people who are on the same path and have the same mission that I do, like you, Tricia, which is one of the reasons I was excited to connect with you here today.
Yeah, I love that. I'm all for it. And I just totally agree. Like, connection to the heart, that's what really feeds our soul. That's what really heals our hunger. So I love that you said that. Mm-hmm. And it's great to have you. Great to connect with you. And thank you for the wonderful work that you're doing. And just carry on and let me know how I can be of support to you.
All right. Thank you. And likewise.
Thank you so much.
If you enjoyed this show and want to get free support, insider health info, exclusive invites to events, and more, visit healyourhunger.com.